This is a unique phenomenon in human history.
C'est une crise, comme vous l'avez dit, d'un genre très particulier parce que c'est la première fois dans l'histoire humaine que face à un danger mortel pour un certain nombre de gens, on a décidé d'arrêter l'économie.
On est dans l'instant permanent.
300,000 people can die every day from hunger.
C'est aussi aux citoyens de dire halt. Je suis surpris par l'obéissance des masses.
The importance of forming judgments. The importance of saying, I will wait to see a transcript before I comment.
Ces plaintes ont quelque chose de totalement indécent.
The coronavirus has had an impact on humanity as a whole.
Welcome to this event organized by the Hexagon Society. The Hexagon Society is a think tank created by a team led by Sophie Wiesenfeld. And tonight we are very pleased to have four rabbis to speak about one special individual, Lord Jonathan Sacks. Mendel Vogel, who kindly accepted to act as the moderator for the event, as well as Lord Rabbi Levy, as well as Rabbi Dweck and Rabbi Kalmenson. So let's kick off now. I will hand it over now to Mendy.
Good evening, everybody. Shavua Tov. I don't speak French, so I hope all those who are in France understand something that I am saying. Rabbi Lord Jonathan Sacks was an individual who had a profound impact on many people, I included. I'm not going to talk about my personal relationship with him, but rather having joined the Western Marble Arch Synagogue, where he was rabbi before he became chief rabbi, and had a very special relationship with the Western Marble Arch Synagogue for the last 15 years whilst I was there. He came probably 6-7 times a year, including coming every Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. You know, like most things in life, one doesn't realize you have something so special until, unfortunately, it is no more. And I do believe with Rabbi Sacks, he was an individual who we always look forward to hearing him talk and inspire and also teach. Besides his very public speaking at Western Marble Arch and many other places, I had the merit of hearing him teach at Western Marble Arch many times. And as erudite and as beautiful his talks were, even to say probably theatre, in the way that he spoke, his ability to teach and inspire was something extraordinary. I was brought up in my father's home. My father had a very special relationship starting in 1968 when he met him as a young student in Cambridge. And the rest is history. We're going to hear from these three fantastic panelists, who have the privilege to know all three of them. So we're going to ask now Rabbi Abraham Levy, former senior rabbi at the Lauderdale Shul, a very well-known individual. He was a founder of the very well-known and successful school, the Imad JPS, as it is called. And we look forward to hearing what Rabbi Levy has to say, his relationship, and reflect on some of the contributions that Rabbi Lord Jonathan Sacks, Olav HaShalom, made to Anglo-Jewry and beyond. Rabbi Levy.
Thank you very much. May I first of all say how delighted I am that I am talking with my distinguished successor, Rabbi Dweck. We've been working together for some time, and also with Rabbi Kalmenson, who has sent a number of pupils from his synagogue in Belgravia to Naima JPS. And I feel as the oldie here, having worked with Rabbi Sacks, having had the honor of working with Rabbi Sacks for over 40 years. Over 40 years. I, of course, was much older than him. And I remember that I had started an organization, which was probably the first in England, to teach together with the Hebrew University young graduates about Judaism in a more sophisticated way. And as I have said before, we had great professors coming to lecture, but there was this young, very young Rabbi Sachs, who was not even 30 at the time, who was the most popular lecturer at the time for those lectures. And since then, of course, we did a lot of work together. You may or may not know that there are two sections of Anglo-Jewry representing major bodies. One is the Spanish and Portuguese congregation, which was started in 1657. And the other one is the Ashkenazi community. And now Rabbi Dweck is the head of the Spanish and Portuguese section, and works together with the present chief rabbi representing Ashkenazim. So whether it is the Council of Christians and Jews, where they're both president, or whether it is the Board of Deputies, or whatever it is, we have always been able to work amicably together. And that is what I did with Jonathan Sachs for many, many, many years. For some time now, I always referred to Jonathan, I do call him Jonathan because we have worked together for so many years, as the chief rabbi of the English-speaking world. But I think I was wrong. I think that he was much more than that. And certainly what has been written about him, the articles, the people expressing their views about him, it was not just the Jewish world. He captivated the moral world who was seeking spiritual guidance. And because in his books he was able to quote from all sources, the following that he had was tremendous. So we should think of him as the moral voice of religion throughout the world. Some years ago, when I was speaking to Rabbi Kalmenson last week, there was a very big meeting at which Rabbi Kalmenson spoke, and so did Lord Sachs. On that occasion, Lord Sachs said very clearly, and I saw the video, that the Lubavitcher Rebbe had said to him, "You've already influenced the Jewish world. Go now and influence the entire world. The people who are seeking a religious angle to their life." And that is indeed what he did. You only have to read his many books and you will find his quotations that he's not just addressing the Jewish people. He is addressing the entire world who is searching for a moral attitude to how they should react in life. Of course, his way was very much Sephardi, if I may say so, because he really followed the unique example of what occurred in Andalusia in the 10th and 11th century. That was the time of Maimonides, who would quote and venerate Aristotle, of Ibn Gabirol, the remarkable poet and thinker, of Shmuel Hanagid, who was really the prime minister of Granada and would go out to war and take his shochet with him because he had to serve his king, but he also had to serve his God. So that was the world which Lord Sachs followed to be able to inspire everybody in the way that these giants in Andalusia had done so many years ago. Yes, I can tell you of numerous things we did together, which were very interesting. At the time, about 15 years ago, we didn't have any rabbinical diploma classes. If people wanted to be in England a rabbi, there were no facilities. So together with the Montefiore Endowment, he and I started classes to train rabbis. And this goes very well. And I must tell you that every single rabbi that we, the Montefiore Endowment, produced. This certificate was first of all signed by Lord Sachs. In many things we did together, the Saatchi Synagogue with Pineduna, which is in my school, Naima Jewish Preparatory School. This was rather a novel idea. People didn't quite know what was going to do. We were going to be providing facilities for Jewish young men and women who would arrive 2 or 3 hours after Shabbat with their cases with them because they were just coming from the office, and they would settle down at the Saatchi Synagogue and be inspired by Pineduna and others. And there again, Rabbi Sachs became very, very helpful in whatever we tried to do. He had his controversies. I just mentioned one particular one, which was mentioned in the Times. And that is the incident that many of you may know of Rabbi Hugo Grin. Rabbi Hugo Grin was a very distinguished Reform rabbi who had made his name because he contributed to a program called the Moral Maze. And he died rather young. And I decided that I was going to go to the funeral, although he was a Reform rabbi. So I phoned Lord Sachs up and I said, I am going. But he had great difficulties because he had to influence everybody, the Orthodox, the ultra-Orthodox, the modern Orthodox, the irreligious, everybody. And he felt, and rightly so, that he wasn't going to go to the funeral. But I took his wife. I took Elaine, and we went to the funeral. I believe I was the only rabbi there, but I felt that he was a Jew, and it was my duty to bury a Jew. This is a mitzvah. And then a lot of controversy followed, people criticizing him. Then wherever he went, he was being attacked from different angles. And this he did the same when he published another book, and some of his own rabbis didn't like it, and they started attacking him. And that's why he was such a great man, because he was able to confront all these attacks, and he was able to make a contribution not only to Anglo-Jewry, not only to world Jewry, but a tremendous contribution to the moral views of the entire world. Amen. Amen.
Thank you very much, Rabbi Levy, for your word, your personal experiences with Rabbi Sachs. We will now move on to Rabbi Dweck. Rabbi Dweck is the senior rabbi of the Sephardic and Portuguese community here in the United Kingdom, successor of Rabbi Levy, a man who has done a great deal for the promotion of the Sephardic community here in this country. I have personally witnessed this on occasion of being at the Lauderdale Synagogue and at other shuls, and it's my honor to introduce Rabbi Dweck to say a few words regarding his reflections and his experiences with Rabbi Lord Sachs. Rabbi Dweck.
Thank you, Rabbi Vogel. Shavua tov. It's a tremendous honor to be able to share some words in the presence of the esteemed rabbis, Rabbi Vogel, Rabbi Kalmenson, and of course my esteemed predecessor, Rabbi Dr. Abraham Levy. To say, you know, to come after Rabbi Levy is a tremendous honor. And I'm grateful for everything that he has worked for his entire life, his entire career, in order to be able to strengthen and promote the infrastructure and life of the Sephardi community here in the United Kingdom. Rabbi Vogel, Rabbi Kalmenson, I'm so honored to be able to speak together with you, as I really do admire and so have such kavod for your work, for your infusing of Kedusha, of Talmud Torah, of Yahdut to your communities and beyond. So thank you. And I also thank Sophie Weisenfeld for having me, for inviting me to be able to participate and to speak with the on behalf of the Hexagon Society, and of course, all of our guests tonight. Shavua Tov. There isn't a great deal that I can say beyond what it is that's been said by Rabbi Levy, but I will offer a perspective with regards to Rabbi Sachs. There has been much that I've had the honor of speaking about Rabbi Sachs. I wish that we were not in the situation where we had to speak about him, but rather that we could listen to him and learn from him, as we will only be able to do from his writings and recorded speeches from now on. The Hachamim say, Agrad hispeda dluye in the Gemara. They say that the merit or the gain that comes out of a hisped, that comes out of a eulogy or speaking of a person that has passed, is what we are able to draw from it for ourselves. I want to look at what it is that Rabbi Sachs did in his life, and it's difficult to be able to speak about it in 10 minutes because it was such a broad, massive work of life that it cannot be properly encapsulated, but one aspect of it, and what it is that we can take from it. You know, Rabbi Sachs inherited a world. You know, he said many times, said to me a few times, that he didn't intend to become a rabbi. And of course, it's very well known how he spoke about the influence of the Lubavitcher Rebbe when he met him when he was a student at Cambridge, and the influence, encouragement of the Rebbe that he should go into the Rabbanut, that he should work on using his wisdom and his spirit, which is not to be underestimated. Rabbi Sachs had a towering intellect, as people said about him, but his heart and spirit was just as great, if not greater. I said before that his heart and his soul subsumed his mind, because all that he knew could have been just what he knew. The fact that it was used to imbue the hearts of the Jewish people and for those beyond the Jewish people was because of his soul and because of his heart. And it was unmatched. It was just as great, if not greater, than his mind. And so the Rebbe said to him, go and use that for the sake of Klal Yisrael and for the Kiddush Hashem. And I will say, and I say emphatically and unabashedly, there is not a person that in recent years, at least in the last decade, if not more, that did more for Kiddush Hashem than Jonathan Sachs. He was just the most outstanding, the most unique, and head and shoulders above everyone else in terms of his ability to be able to be Mekadesh Shem Shamayim, to sanctify the name of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and to give grace and name to the people of Israel, to Klal Yisrael. And I want to explain, there are many reasons why, but I want to share one reason why. Rabbi Sachs, you know, by choosing to go into the rabbinate in the way that he did, he was coming from being a student in Cambridge and reading philosophy and reading it quite well. To choose to go into the rabbinate was perilous. And it was perilous because he inherited a world, you know, essentially the 20th century, the latter end of the 20th century, that for all intents and purposes had its soul stolen from it. The development of the Enlightenment moved the Western world steadily into a place of nihilism. And the reason for that is because we learned so much and we began to have such broad knowledge and understanding of our world that the things that we took as part of our world, morality, spirituality, ethics, were all turned on their head. They were all challenged. Nietzsche proclaimed brazenly that God is dead. And after him, the existentialist philosophers like Sartre and Heidegger and Camus and the ilk of the existentialist thinkers stole the soul and heart away from the Western world. And while we felt very strong in our thinking, and when I say we, I mean the Western world, I don't mean the Jewish people, while we felt very strong in our thinking in general, we felt tremendously anxious and in a malaise as a result of having lost our spirituality and our firm sense of morality. And so the world was left very cold. For us, the Jewish people, we insulated ourselves. We kept warm when the outside was frigid and losing its soul and ultimately its connection to God and to the divine. And so we spoke amongst ourselves as best we could. We reminded ourselves of the beauty of our Torah, of the holiness of our Torah, of the sanctity of our souls. Every morning when we said, Elohai, neshama shenatata bi tehora, my Lord, the soul that you gave me is pure. We reinforced our strength, but we were holding out a very difficult edifice to hold. Outside, the frost was coming in. our children were going out and they were experiencing these frigid environments in terms of their spirituality. And we needed somebody who could step out into the cold and be able, with the haval piv, with the words of his mouth, to warm not only us, but the world itself, to be able to go out and speak with authority, to be able to speak with strength in the face of the nihilist thought that was proliferating in the world. And he did so. And he did so, and he stood strong. And what he did, and that's why it was important, because what Rabbi Sacks did was he spoke outwardly. He spoke to us, and he was criticized sometimes for being the chief rabbi that spoke outward rather than speaking inward. But I believe very strongly that is precisely what it is that he needed to do. Because as he was speaking out there, he was walking us out. And the reason why it was important to walk us out is because our children were already out. They were venturing out. And he needed to speak from a place of authority. And so he used their thinking. He said, I know all of your thought. And I know everything that you've said. And I could say it to you better than you can. And still I stand in full strength. And I proclaim that faith is to be held central and at the foundation of our lives, unabashedly and without self-consciousness. And so, Rabbi Sacks, he wrote many books, but one of the most important, I believe, that he wrote, which was based on this idea, was To Heal a Fractured World. And I want to quote one thing that he says in this book. He says, in Judaism, faith is not acceptance, but protest against the world, in the name of the world that is not yet, but ought to be. And Rabbi Sacks taught not only us, but the world at large, that it was not only okay, but brave to be able to live a life of faith and connection with God, and to be able to know that the world is not just some empty, frigid place that we have to find some meaning to instill into it so that we could carry on with our lives and not deteriorate into insanity, but that we could draw from the holiness of the world itself that comes from its creator. Rabbi Sacks was able to do that in a way that gained the greatest respect of secular and religious thinkers alike. And to be able to watch, if there's one thing that we can take from all of it, is to look at how it is that the world has responded to his passing. The world has responded to his passing with honor and with bowed heads of thanks, both secular and religious. And if there is anything that could teach us that what it is that he has said was true, that we should listen to what it is that he told us, to be proud of our legacy, of our Torah, of our holiness, and to teach it and speak it to the world, to be able to walk outside and hold our heads high and to warm the world around us as he did, in whatever management and whatever way it is that we can, it's to be able to see how it is that people responded to him, how they thanked him for his life and for his words. And so that is something that I personally am tremendously grateful for, and I think that all of us need to be grateful for, and that it is important to be able to read his words and understand them. And so I do recommend, if based on that idea, what I am sharing, read To Heal a Fractured World, because it's from that Rabbi Sacks really was able to put out how it is that we go out, how it is that we step out into a frigid, nihilistic, existentialist world and hold our Torah strong and warm everything that's around us and remember our connection to HaKadosh Baruch Hu and the beauty of what it means to be Am Yisrael.
Thank you very much, Rabbi Dweck, for your kind words. Obviously, we see, and it is apparent, the impact and influence Rabbi Sacks had with you. Before I introduce our final panelist, Rabbi Kalmenson, I would just like to remind everybody that there is a Q&A at the bottom where you can write your question. And obviously, I will give it to the panelists that you have asked the question to. Our final panelist, Rabbi Kalmenson, is also a dear friend, Ashtikul Mishpacha as well. That's some family through his wife. Rabbi Kalmenson, as many of you know, is the rabbi at Beit Baruch. He's also the director of Chabad of Belgravia here in London. And in a very short time, his influence has been felt by many, many people. He recently published a book called Positivity Bias. He's also the author of the popular book Seeds of Wisdom and A Time to Heal. And although new to London, relatively new, I'm sure he has a lot to say, and we look forward to his words. Rabbi Kalmenson.
Thank you very much, Rabbi Mendy. Shavua tova, gutavach. And I first want to open by by noting and celebrating my really illustrious and esteemed, I wouldn't even say colleagues, because everyone on this panel stands above and shears and illuminates. Rabbi Levy, I've gained inspiration and insight from you and the work you've done to revolutionize Jewish education, and particularly for youth, is transformative. And that's not a word to use lightly. I know that Rabbi Sachs, Allah Shalom, in his own personal sharing, would talk very often about what he felt was perhaps his greatest contribution during the chief rabbinate, which was the proliferation of Jewish day schools and higher rates of attendance to something like 70%. I heard him say that on a number of occasions. And I think, Rabbi Levy, you're one of those mavericks who spearheaded that effort. Kol hakavod to you, and may Hashem grant you tremendous health and koach and energy to continue your avodat hakodesh. It's also a real privilege and pleasure to be here with Rabbi Dweck, who is a really special gem that has made tremendous mark. And if I may say, has gone in the very steps he described Rabbi Sachs paved, and taking the beauty and Judaism and bringing it to a contemporary modern context and society, and really reaching precisely those who are venturing or who have already stepped out in ways that I think are singular. So kol hakavod, Rabbi Dweck. We all watch you, observe you, and absorb your teachings, and in some way, shape, or form, try to emulate that in our surroundings. And of course, Rabbi Mendel Vogel, he does more than what a typical rabbi does, I think, actually. In a certain way, Mendel, your reach is more widespread in so many areas of Jewish life, whether people know about it or they don't. Behind the scenes, you're facilitating, you're organizing, you're putting things together, and you're ensuring that the joy and specifically the connectivity of Jewish people grows from strength to strength. And one more thanks, of course, to Sophie, who has done so much to bring people together around intellectual, spiritual, emotional, psychological, political stimulation, which we all know is essential in these times, to have a space to elevate and to escape from perhaps the disruption and disorientation our world is currently experiencing. I want to share the following reflection. After Steve Jobs died in 2011, a one-line obituary in the mainstream media caught my attention. It said, Steve Jobs put a powerful computer inside a phone, and that phone into 120 million pockets. And it struck me then that throughout history, the people who left the greatest mark on the world, those who became household names, were not necessarily those who created life-changing inventions, but were those who gave the public access to those life-changing innovations. Access seems like an innocent enough word and an uninspiring enough concept. After all, it suggests that the giver of access created nothing of his or her own and merely distributed someone else's genius. But in fact, it is access that has been behind some of the world's greatest transformations and revolutions. Just think of recent household names like Mark Zuckerberg from Facebook, Sergey Brin of Google, Jan Kwam of WhatsApp, Peter Thiel of PayPal, Jeff Bezos of Amazon, and the list goes on and on. The common denominator of them all, and the reason we know their names, is not because of their academic genius or political or technological prowess, but because of the access they have given us all, changing the way we shop, we transfer money, we research, we keep in touch with family and friends. And in Jewish history as well, we remember and celebrate those who opened the gates of Jewish knowledge and experience to the masses. Of all the things he could be remembered for, his legendary leadership, his unique level of prophecy, his moral imagination, Moshe, or Moshe Rabbeinu, as he has lovingly been called by Torah giants and laymen alike throughout Jewish history, is remembered simply as our teacher. And the same can be said of Rebbe, the compiler of the Mishnah, and Rambam through his Mishneh Torah, and Rabbi Yosef Ka'aro, and the Alter Rebbe through their respective Shulchan Aruchs or codes of Jewish law, each of whom in their own day and in their own way made Talmudic law available to those who often had neither the time or the ability to engage directly with the depth and the breadth of the Talmud. Another notable example is that of Rashi, arguably the most renowned of biblical commentators, who wrote in the preface of his commentary to the Torah, Ani lo batzi lefarish al pshuto shel mikra. I have done no more than attempt to make available the plain meaning of the text. What makes the great men mentioned so relevant and beloved to the Jewish people, hundreds and even thousands of years after their passing, is the fact that instead of only devoting or exclusively devoting their intellectual genius to the creation of novel Torah interpretation and commentary, they devoted their intellectual energy and output towards making available Jewish knowledge to one and all. And the same is true not only of Jewish knowledge, but of Jewish experience. Take the holy Baal Shem Tov, for example, who became known and endeared to the Jewish people for his efforts to make Judaism accessible to the illiterate and downtrodden Jewish masses in his time and meaningful to uninitiated Jews in future times. And more recently, it was the Lubavitcher Rebbe of righteous memory, one of the great inspirations of Rabbi Sachs, Alav HaShalom, as mentioned by both Rabbi Levy and Dweck, as Rabbi Sachs was so often to mention, who helped revolutionize the way in which Jewish people are given access to their precious heritage, leading the effort, which has since become ubiquitous to the Orthodox Jewish world, to expand and proliferate as many Jewish access points as possible, both geographically and experientially. But just a few weeks ago, our world lost one of its most eloquent exponents and proponents of Judaism to the world, and truly a unique luminary who did more than any in recent memory, and with greater reach and relevance to make accessible the beauty and joy of Torah, tradition, and faith. Through his covenant and conversation, he unpacked Jewish wisdom by seamlessly fusing philosophy, theology, and psychology, providing the subtext and the context for the text of our Holy Torah. Through his myriad articles, books, and media presentations, he brilliantly articulated such themes as faith and morality to a modern and progressive world who, as Rabbi Dweck spoke so beautifully and so concisely about just moments ago, who sees such themes and ideas as tired, as dated, and even antiquated. And Rabbi Sachs truly created a whole new language and paradigm by which to advance and make accessible the benefits of such essential ingredients to human well-being. I think it's fair to say that Rabbi Sachs, Alav HaShalom, took one of the most venerable places in the illustrious line of great Jewish leaders dating back to Moshe, who made it their life's mission to unlock and distribute the joys and depth of Judaism to every Jew and beyond. You know, a number of years ago, we had the privilege and pleasure of hosting Rabbi Yisrael Meir Lau, the great former chief rabbi of Israel. And as happens when we have guest speakers, I usually have a phone call a week or two before to discuss the various themes they're going to touch on. And Rabbi Lau asked me, what would you like me to talk about during Shabbat afternoon lunch? And I said, you know, we have a community of business people. We have a community of professionals. We have a community of individuals who are very much a part of the wider world. And perhaps a theme you might touch on is the importance of being a Or Lagoyim, a light unto the nations. And I remember very vividly, I could still hear the sound of Rabbi Lau's voice, in a certain sense, vehemently rebutting, like, Or Lagoyim, he said, or even screamed in a nice, gentle way, Or LaYehudim, he says. I need to talk to them of being a light unto the nations. I'm going to talk to them of being a light unto their nation, unto our nation. And when he did come, he spent the entire talk talking about the importance of marrying Jewish, of Jewish education, and it was a very powerful and impactful talk. I share that with you because I think there have been, in recent centuries and throughout Jewish history, those who have excelled at being an Or LaYehudim, a light to the Jewish people. And then there were those few, and I would say truly those few, who made it their life's mission to be an Or LaGoyim, to speak to the wider world. But there have been very, very few, if any, that have managed in the way that Rabbi Sachs managed to be both an Or LaYehudim and Or LaGoyim. Such a difficult balance, such an impossible negotiation of a very real tension. Really and truly, as Rabbi Dweck said beautifully, he took us outward. He turned the Jewish community in a certain sense outward, making us focus not only on the inside but the outside, but in so doing, bringing joy and pride back home. So as we gather to commemorate the life and the legacy of this unique light of our time, it pays well for Jewish leaders and chaplains and community organizers, and really any member of the Jewish people committed to Jewish unity, community, and continuity, to reflect on the life and legacy of Rabbi Sachs, of accessible Judaism, and to emulate his example in our schools, in our neighborhoods, in the communities we build the world over, turning the words of Yeshayahu, enlarge the place of your tent into a living reality. May his name and memory be a blessing to us all.
Thank you very much, Rabbi Kalmenson, for your words. I'm sure many people would agree the panelists here this evening have shared of what much is known, but some of it is not known. And we appreciate, I say we on behalf of the Hexagon Society and the many attendees here this evening, appreciate your kind words. Before we go to question and answers, you know, Rabbi Levy, Rabbi Dweck, and Rabbi Kalmenson talked about his ability to influence or have a profound effect on non-Jewish or the non-Jewish community too. It is obviously apparent when you have the kind words of His Royal Highness Prince Charles on many occasions at going to Western Marble Arch. There were some fascinating guests, which included some archbishop or some bishop, I don't know, I forget their name, but Rabbi Sachs was able to talk easily with both the most learned and Lahavdil, you know, the Goyim who respected his encyclopedic knowledge. You know, what was one of the highlights of our time at Western Marble Arch was always the question and answers. And you know how it is on Yom Kippur, Rosh Hashanah, the question and answers, people sort of head for the doors, get some fresh air. No one left because Rabbi Sachs got up and there was always some incredible question, which at times when the question was concluded, if it was a long question posed by someone, you would think, you know, it would take maybe a few seconds, 10 seconds to, you know, gather your thoughts and then respond. And Rabbi Sachs instantly would go into this talk and give you a history and a background and context. It was breathtaking, his encyclopedic knowledge, which I was fortunate, and I know many others were fortunate to see that. Rabbi Sachs will be surely missed, not just for my personal reflections, but for everybody who had, and I believe, influenced by this giant of an individual. We have a few questions. The first questions will be for Rabbi Levy. Can you please comment on the excellent contribution and or of Rabbi Sachs to Ne'imah?
Tremendous contribution, because the whole concept of what we're trying to do in Ne'imah is what he tried to do in so much of his work during his chief rabbinate. He would come to Ne'imah, he would encourage us, we would invite him for special occasions. And the whole philosophy of Ne'imah. The philosophy of Ne'imah is one that we don't ask before a person comes how religious they are. Anybody who is a Jew or wants to be a better Jew is more than welcome. We don't ask what they do on Shabbat. We don't insist that they wear a kippah, except, of course, for religious studies. We don't insist that you put on your tzitzit unless you want it. And then I would give them a present to wear it. And the interesting thing is that because of that, there are numerous pupils at Ne'imah JPS whose parents are not religious. And they know perfectly well that we are a religious school, but they come because they respect religion. And very often it is the children who teach the parents, and suddenly the parents carry on studying and becoming more religious. And that was Lord Sachs' ideas and philosophies. He didn't reject anyone. A lot of his quarrels sometimes because he wanted to reach out to everybody. But some of his more right-wing rabbis made his life very difficult indeed. There was the incident when he published a book and they forced him to try to change it. The philosophy of Ne'imah is very much like Lord Sachs. We accept everybody. And from there, we see what we can do to improve them.
Thank you very much, Rabbi Levy. Appreciate that. A question for Rabbi Dweck. The Jewish synagogues face a dilemma with the COVID situation on whether to open doors. It is difficult for the community to gather, and it is the center of our religion to be together. From what you know of Rabbi Sachs, how would he have recommended if this situation was to last for a long period of time?
These questions are all, I'm always wary to answer, because anytime someone asks me to say, what would the other person have said? I answer with trepidation. So all I could say is what, you know, having known Rabbi Sachs and indeed how the tremendous emphasis that he placed on communal life and connection. He was also a man of tremendous reason and groundedness. And I know that Rabbi Sachs would have been extremely concerned and cautious about two things. One, about the virus itself. We know that people die from this, and that even if we are ourselves okay, we carry it, and God forbid, can bring it to people that we love very much and that we have a requirement to care for and to watch is made sure to protect them. And it's a dangerous situation. So I think that he would be quite wary about that. But there's another thing that I know that Rabbi Sachs held of the highest degree. And that was, like I said, Kiddush Hashem. And he would be extremely concerned if the behavior of the Jewish community, and I know especially as chief rabbi, that if the behavior of the Jewish community brought any cause for people to say that there was a lack of care among the Jewish community, or that the community, the Jewish community was not concerned or not wary of the great issues that we're facing, or for that matter, that they didn't listen to the government and didn't do what the government asked them to do as good citizens, he would certainly caution against that. That said, within permitted parameters, Rabbi Sachs would encourage anyone who could go and participate in community life within safety and the guidelines of the government to do so. He would be worried, as I am, about people. You know, the law of physics, Newton's law of physics, says an object at rest tends to stay at rest. And we have unfortunately become used to being at rest and not engaging in synagogue and not engaging in our communal life as we normally are used to having it. So he would encourage people to break the rest and engage as much as they could within the parameters that were allowed. And thank God the parameters are allowed. All person has to make personal decisions, but he would certainly encourage people engage in their Jewish life as best they possibly could, given the circumstances. But that again is what I imagine, knowing Rabbi Sachs, what he would have said.
Thank you very much, Rabbi Dweck. This question is for Rabbi Kalmenson. Rabbi Sachs was a man in the world talking to Jews and Gentiles. As a Jewish-French young man here in London, I learned from him in one of the TED conferences how important it is to spread the message of Judaism to the world by opposition to reserving it within the community. That's the question, Rabbi Kalmenson. The question is basically, do we have the Judaism with all its beautiful teachings?
Yeah.
Do we have a responsibility to share it with others?
The simple answer is 100%. The term Orla Goyim or Mamlechet Kohanim, which defines the Jewish mission statement and raison d'etre, really, very clearly communicates that the Jewish people are an instrument, God's instrument to the world. We have something to teach, to share, and to help transform the world, and that is given to us via the Torah. And the Torah's message doesn't only speak to the Jew, it speaks to all human beings. In fact, my teacher and mentor, which was mentioned numerous times throughout this evening, Rabbi, the great Rebbe of Lubavitch, he did something very unusual. And he was actually very strongly criticized by other members of the Orthodox and so-called ultra-Orthodox communities. He started a campaign called the Seven Noahide Law Campaign. Many of you will know that there are 613 mitzvot given to the Jewish people in the Torah, but there are also seven laws that are universal in application and are relevant to each and every human being, every one of God's children on this blessed earth. And it's our mission as Jews, as beautifully articulated by the Rambam in his Mishneh Torah, to teach those seven laws to the wider world. And when the Rebbe was actually criticized, he said something interesting. He was asked, but this goes against Jewish tradition. Jewish leaders never saw their role as talking to the world. And he answered a number of answers, which goes beyond the scope of tonight's discussion. But one answer was very practical. He says, exactly when was the great Jewish community meant to be talking to the wider world? In 1492, when they were busy being expelled by the Spanish Inquisition? In 1290, when they were expelled from this wonderful country in the UK? When exactly were they meant to talk to the world? They were busy being faced with the sword and the cross. That was their experience, existential threat for thousands of years. But Baruch Hashem, we live in unique times. And those unique times afford us and actually, in a certain sense, demand of us to do whatever we can to speak to the wider world. Let me just conclude by saying, how do Jewish people know the plot? How do we know the story? You know, I was once asked an interesting question. How did the Rebbe keep so optimistic and so positive? How is he so certain that we are heading towards positive times, towards messianic times, etc.? And I share with them that I have a friend who is hates gore, hates suspense, and has a very difficult time, therefore, watching suspenseful movies, thrillers. So how do they get over their phobia? So what they do is basically they watch the last 10 minutes of the film. And once they know how the film's going to end, they then go back to the beginning and watch it from the beginning. Now, you and I know that that's really counterproductive. We usually read a novel or watch a film precisely because of that lesson, you know, the suspense that it keeps us in. But either way, I said the Rebbe and Jewish leaders throughout history, you know why they were so positive and optimistic? Because they watched the end of the film, because they knew the end of the story. They knew the plot. And how did they know the plot? Because they read the Nevi'im. They read our holy prophets. And our prophets are the ones who laid out the vision of history and taught us that the arc of history bends forward. And in those teachings, in Zephaniah and Yeshayahu and many others, we talk of a reality and world where the Gentile population will come to the Jewish community asking, teach us from your holy wellsprings. It says 10 Gentiles will run to a Jew and pull at his kaftan or whatever the exact language and say, teach me Torah. We're all familiar with the beautiful words made famous by one of the Kalbach songs, but a sukkim that we all should know from Haftorah, etc., that in the end of days, Hinei Amin Ba'im Ne'um Hashem, the end of days are coming, and at that time I will bring a famine to the world, but it will not be a famine for bread. Ki'im l'shmoa et devar Hashem, thirst and a hunger to hear the word of God. And I think Rabbi Sacks tapped into that thirst and that hunger, and it's something Rabbi Dweck really talked about earlier. That void, that backlash to hyper-secularism and individualism, to what Rabbi Sacks beautifully called a cultural climate change that brings us into a post-secular reality and world, where now we are seeing that this experimental secularism, while positive in some ways, has left major, major holes and voids in human well-being, like identity, belonging, tradition, morality, etc. So Rabbi Sacks understood that. He really felt the pulse, and he delivered, like no one else. And I think that's something that we all should do, in each one of us in our own way. I just want to say one little point mentioning the thirst. You know, and again, Rabbi Levy and Rabbi Dweck, I think you alluded to this. You know, there's a saying in the Talmud that if you want to really get to know someone, you can get to know them in a few ways, either through, it's a pun, but when they get angry, when they're intoxicated, or how they, or their spending habits. One sage adds, or by what they find funny, which is interesting in itself. But I would add that the best way to get to know someone is by how they express they would want themselves to be remembered. We have often interviews with great people, and I often ask them, how would you like to be remembered? It's an incredibly poignant question, and it's a sobering question, and it has the ability to really shift our paradigm and essentialize for us what matters most in life. Rabbi Sacks, as many of you might know, on a desert island interview, shared exactly how he would like to be remembered, what his epitaph should be when he passes into the next world. And he said it should be the verse from our holy scriptures, Tzama lecha nafshi, kama lecha b'sari be'eretz tzieva ayef bli mayim. And Rabbi Lionel Rosenfeld from Western Marble Arts sang that powerful song at the Levaya of Rabbi Sacks of blessed memory. We tend to look at Rabbi Sacks as this incredibly eloquent spokesperson, ambassador for the Jewish people to the wider world, which he was. But if you want to know Rabbi Sacks in his pure essence, who he was, that is to say, what made him tick, what excited him, what was most important to him, you need to merely listen to how he describes it himself. He said, I want to be remembered as a person who thirsted for the knowledge and the connection to Hashem. And that's a part of Rabbi Sacks, I think, that we need to talk more about, because it's not gotten enough attention. When you saw him singing with those children in the Oseh Shalom video, and Rabbi Mendel Vogel, you would have seen him so many more times than most on this call, you saw him break out in pure bliss and joy, singing the words of Hashem, connecting to God Almighty. I think for me, at least, that serves as a very powerful inspiration. He didn't become so eloquent as to become aloof, cerebral, and academic and intellectual in the sense that he was disconnected from the emotion and the passion of Yiddishkeit. To the contrary, the passion and the emotion of Yiddishkeit is what made him tick most. And I think we would pay well to internalize that.
Thank you very much, Rabbi Kalmenson. We are coming up to 7 o'clock, and I'd like to conclude as follows. There's a Corinne Levy Laurent who wants to highlight Jonathan Sacks' behavior and love of children, all children. Those who talked to him absolutely loved him. And you know, when you talk about greatness, there's greatness at many different levels. And Rabbi Sacks was able to converse with the great and the mighty and the intellectuals, etc. But he was also able to converse with simple children. And when a child spoke to him, it was literally like his whole being was there. It was quite profound. I was going to mention Rabbi Kalmenson mentioned the story of what Rabbi Rosenfeld mentioned at his Levaya about what his epitaph would like to have been. But I want to conclude with a story with which Rabbi Sachs, who also being interviewed, I think it was with Classic FM. He was a great lover of songs and also of a classicist, including, by the way, for those of you who don't know, at Western Marble Art, Rabbi Sachs used to daven shachris. You know, if you're a big chazan, you can't do shachris and musaf the whole day. So Rabbi Sachs used to daven shachris. And in the many songs, whether it was on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, you know, there's a few people who knew some Chabad nigunim, and he would always turn around to me and make sure that I would sing loudly with him, because not many people were familiar with some of the songs, but he wanted to sing all the time. In this interview, Rabbi Sachs made a very profound impression upon me, certainly highlighting in the times that we live in. In this interview, Rabbi Sachs shared this incredible story of Yitzchak Perlman. I apologize for those of you who know it, but Rabbi Sachs told the story as follows. Yitzchak Perlman, the great violinist, was giving a concert at the Carnegie Hall, a sold-out event, naturally. And in the middle of him, of this very difficult piece, his violin snapped. One of the strings snapped. And incredibly, I don't know how many people can do it, but Yitzchak Perlman was certainly one such individual. And he was able to conclude the song, the piece, with only three strings. And after the concert, they came over to Yitzchak Perlman, and they asked him, you know, everybody would have understood if you would have asked for another violin or to restring it. We understand if it snaps, you start again. And Yitzchak Perlman responded, he says, this is a very powerful, a profound lesson for life. He said, in life, you have to make the best with what you have. And, you know, today we're living at a time where a lot of things we can't do, can't gather in the shul, we can't be inspired by our rabbis, our communities, but we have to do the best we can. And Rabbi Sachs was an individual who was always able to see the best in everyone. He was always able to look at the positive and the ability to come out of something so difficult and so challenging. And I believe he will be a source of great, continue to be a great source of pride, even though he's not with us physically. But as Rabbi Dweck mentioned, his many books and his many teachings, and now today with all the videos and talks, etc., and please God, for many, many more years, the books that Rabbi Sachs has translated that we can learn for a long time to come. So before I conclude, I just want to obviously give thanks to our host this evening. For those of you who don't know, the Hexagon Society is a Franco-British intellectual movement which aims to promote writers, intellectuals, and artists from France and London and bring unique cultural content. It was established in 2016, and it is a fantastic organization. It is at a recognized British charity, and they're doing some fantastic projects, and I would encourage everyone to join and support this very important body. Rabbi Levy, it was a pleasure, and thank you very much for taking the time on this Motzah Shabbat, and Rabbi Dweck and Rabbi Kalmenson, and we wish all of you and your respective communities much health, and you, the rabbis, to have lots of nachat, lots of pride and joy from your communities, and may we only meet each other on happy occasions and celebrate many, many wonderful things together. I'll say it in Yiddish and then translate gesundheit und freilichheit, in good health and with great joy. Shavua tov, everyone.
Amen. Thank you, Rabbi Vogel. Shavua tov.
Shavua tov.
Shavua tov.
Shavua tov.